Next we go to generators. So here we have to look at the infinitesimal transformations. The infinitesimal transformations are, so all we have to do is look at those transformation matrix. It is in the other language, yeah, this language. Is Kosh, Sinch, Sinch, Kosh. They have just the same kind of expansions as sine and cosine, except for the fluctuate. Oh, the most important difference between the rotations and these is, aside from the fact that there are hyperbolic trigonometric functions, there is a minus sign here and a plus sign here. These signs are always opposite for real rotations. Depending on the convention used, the minus sign may be here or there, but they are oppositely signed. Whereas in boost, these will always be the same signed. So if it was boost in the opposite direction, then both the sine hyperbolics will change sign and you will get both minus signs. So in the present case, Kosh Psi, Sinch Psi, if you expand out the Kosh, it is 1 to first order, and then there will be Psi times 0, 1, 1, 0. The Sinch series is just the odd powers with divided by the number factorial with no sign changes. They are both essentially becoming exponential for large. So there are no signs, fluctuating signs, and this is all we have. And plus order psi squared, which will come for the expansion of Kosh, but we look at the linear term, then this is all we have. So in 4D notation, we have K1, which is same as Kx, equal to, so we call it Kx 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, and the 3 by 3 part, which is rotations, will be a big 0. But as I said, as per Steven Weinberg's notation, I will fill it with zeros. Then K2, which is same as Ky, would be equal to 0, 0, 1 and 0, and 0, 1 and 0. So the 1 just migrates along the top and the bottom, and this 3 by 3 submatrix of rotations remains null. And doesn't require much imagination to, so you can fill it out, 0, 0, 0, 1 and 0, 1 and all other zeros. Now just as for the rotation matrices, we would like to know the algebra of these. Okay. So we have to see what these things do under mutual commutation. Algebra of boost generators Ki. Now here is where I run into a lot of grief with signs, and I hope that you will bear with me. So I have some notes, actually I'll put these up, but I found that the notes have sign problems. So you should believe the results I tell you and work out the matrix multiplication yourself, But let us, since there is time and since we never have any tutorial hour, let us try to do kx, ky and see what we get. Kx, ky and commutator. So 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. And if you do want to save time, put 0 here and then 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, big 0 here. Now, yeah, I am trying to put ky first and times kx. So, what do we get? So, the only non-zero term here is the one that comes from second row and third column. So, second row and minus third row and second column. This is equal to our old friend LZ. Yeah, LZ had a, so this is minus of LZ. This is LZ because it is in the 1, 2 location. So this is giving XY rotation basically with 1 here and a minus 1 here. And our convention, the way I remember we introduced the active rotations, was that this is equal to minus of LZ. And therefore is equal to I times JZ. We had set JZ equal to I times LZ. JZ equal to I times LZ. So LZ equal to minus I times JZ. So minus L is equal to I times JZ. Okay. So we expect that ki kj to produce I times j epsilon ijk jk. If I take kx and ky, right, this is kx and this is ky. And it produces jz. So we expect that the algebra is ki kj equal to I epsilon ijk this. The next thing to check is what happens between j and k. And this is where I had some problem with sign. So you will see where the sign crops up in a most important way. Most of this that we are writing, it does not really matter. But anyway, let me next try to do kx and jz. So, can you do kx and jz in your book? And better fill out everything. Whereas jz is equal to I times LZ, and LZ has 1 here, so there is I and minus I. So next, consider this. All the other things are going to be 0 and minus. Third row into second column, which is going to be equal to minus I. Sorry, so minus I is over. So what do we get? We get I times kx, isn't it? Ky. So thus we expect that ki, so let us first write kx jz was equal to I times ky. So what do we expect? Ki, but this is in reverse order, so we should, so zx would be more correct, would be minus, so better write it as ji so this is same as jz kx equal to minus I ky, or ji kj equal to minus I epsilon I j k k k. Okay. So now we have this algebra. All this looks pretty boring, but now something interesting happens. So summary, by the way, this is worked out in Jackson's electrodynamics book, chapter 13 has all this written out in great detail. He does not use complex notation, but I did try to check the sign, but there are all these binary choices. Do you use active rotations or passive rotations? Do you use active boosts or passive boosts? You write J first or K first, so the signs have to be worked out, but it is all there in Jackson's book. Electrodynamics book, it is there, chapter 12, I think, special relativity. So we are not doing something all that terribly exotic so far. But now let us see what is the summary. Firstly, we had the good old ji jj equal to I epsilon I jk jk. Then we calculated ki kj. equal to I epsilon I j k j k, and finally we had j I k j, which is equal to minus I epsilon I j k k k. This is the total SO31 algebra or the Lorentz group algebra. What is interesting to note is that if you have two boosts, if you commute two successive boosts, you actually get a pure rotation. Okay. So, in atomic physics, this was discovered because some factor half was not coming out correctly. It is called Larmor precession, if I am not mistaken. So, Larmor physically worked out the electron orbiting the atom, and then it is here and then it is there. So, there are two successive boosts. Those successive boosts amount to a rotation of the electron. So, and we'll tell you a little more about it quickly soon. So, two boosts commute to give a rotation, but then a rotation and a boost mix things produces a boost. Now, let us try to understand physically what this, why it is like this. So, this is the boxable result. And I hope that signs in it are all correct. So let us understand and write an easier way of remembering this. So the better notation actually is to remember that the z rotation is actually xy plane rotation. When we say that I rotate around z axis, this is a convenience of three dimensions, because actually the rotation is happening in xy plane, and to say that it is around z axis, there is a unique third axis in only in three dimensions. In many dimensions, there would be many, many axes that are orthogonal to xy. So, the calling it a z rotation is actually just a luxury of 3D. Really speaking, jz is actually jxy. Okay. So, the rotation, infinitesimal rotations are in planes. Occur in planes, not really around an axis. Except in 3D. In fact, this is the reason I can now tell you, if you have suffered with this notion all along, why is it that I have to, when I take cross product, I have to erect it perpendicular to the plane in which I take the cross product. Okay. And I have to use right hand screw rule. What happens if I use left hand screw rule? Well, they say it is matter of convention. Well, if it is convention, it can be very physical, right? So, there is actually no perpendicular vector sticking out of the planes. It is actually within the plane, and the rotation is actually a second rank tensor and not a vector. So, the correct way, so maybe we will come to that at some other point when we come to representations. For the time being, note that actually it is not the axis of rotation. So, it is a two index object, not really one index object. So, similarly, the k x is basically, let us call it m 0 x, there is time and space, okay. So the ki are basically tx plane rotations. If you now think like this, then we know j, remember what we used to write x, y, z. So x is actually y, z, and y is z x is equal to I times j. So x, y would have given j, z, but z is equal to x, y. This is what the commutation algebra is. And what does this say? It says that if there is a yz rotation, okay, let us similarly write down say this k I k j, okay, so the k 0 I k 0 j becomes equal to I times j. So let us be specific, so make it 0 x and 0 y. Then from this algebra we know that this is jz, but jz is equal to xy. Now what do we see common between these? What is happening is that if I have a yz rotation followed by zx rotation, not really followed but commutation, then the z drops out and I am left with an xy plane rotation. Xy, yz becomes xz directly. If I have 0x and 0y, then the 0 drops out and I basically get an xy rotation. If I have larger number of dimensions, if I rotate 1, 2 plane and 7, 9 plane, and later I rotate 7, 9 first and 1, 2, they are going to be independent, they will all commute, okay. So those rotations that share one axis are equivalent to the rotation which is the two, where the shared axis drops out. So if it is z and z, then there is no z here, 0 and 0, there is no 0 here. So aside from sign conventions, that is what is happening, okay. And in general we will have so we can also quickly check the third thing, where if I take jx and ky, I should get I times, so which is, sorry, so which is same as jx is equal to yz and ky is k0y. What do I get? I get from this jx xy is equal to minus I jz becomes equal to z is equal to minus xy, x is equal to, this is k, sorry, thank you, that is why I was going wrong. So it becomes k 0 z. That again we see the same rule, if it is yz and 0 y, then y is going to drop out and I will get a 0 z rotation. So this is basically how the algebra operates, and therefore if you go to larger dimensions, then planes that are independent, that do not share any axis, they will just commute. Here too you can think of 0 x and y z, so also check. This should be equal to 0. So yz is equal to jx But according to this algebra, if the two indices are, because there is epsilon tensor here, if these two are equal, this is 0. So this is indeed 0. So if you have completely independent planes, 0x plane and yz plane, then the commute. That is the moral of this whole exercise, and that is its basic geometry. It captures the geometry of rotations. We can check that for SON, we can introduce well, first let us just say M I j with I j running over 1 to n for I j plane real rotation. Then we will find what do you expect? M I j M K L to be equal to what? So I am guessing if I equals K, then I will drop out and j k j l will remain. So delta I j I k M j l then there will be a, so next if I equals L, then I should put delta I L and I should be left with M J K, except that because I am matching a first sign with a second sign, there will be a relative minus sign. Similarly, a relative minus sign and delta J K M I L, and finally J equal to K M I K, and the overall sign I do not know, okay, it is plus or minus 1, that one has to check by checking one of them correctly in detail, but this is what we expect it to be. If the two infinitesimal rotations share any one axis, then we get an, only if they share one axis, then we get a non-zero answer. And if neither I equals K nor, if I does not equal K or L and J does not equal K or L, then we will get 0. That is this. So SON algebra will be like this, we worked it out, you know. No need to be afraid of higher number of dimensions. Yes. Okay, so let us see, first one I put as delta I k and j l, in the end I should put delta j l and I k. Right. So aside from an overall sign which you can fix, so when string theorists tell you you have to live in 10 dimensions, you have to say I am prepared, I can rotate in 10 dimensions. So this is algebra of SON. Now we come back to the algebra of SO31, and there are some interesting things here. So representations of the Lorentz group for now, when we had the 3D rotations, we had this clever J plus J minus construction. But now we have 6 generators, corresponding to the 6 parameters. So, by the way, I hope you know how to count. These are the they have to be orthogonal, so only the upper triangle matters, the lower triangle is minus of those that are above, and the upper triangle in 4 by 4 matrices is 6. So, there are 6 parameters, and how do we generate their representations? So, here there was this clever trick by Hermann Weyl. It says the following. So, by the way, Dirac was considered a wizard by most people of his generation and later ones who have read his papers. And Dirac was famous for not answering anything in more than one word at a time, monosyllabic, yes, no, maybe, or keep quiet, say nothing. So, there, if you Google interview of Paul Dirac at I think it was University of Wisconsin or Minnesota, one of these northern universities. So, interview of Paul Dirac, you will find this one web page of an interview taken by a Wisconsin journalist, and he is an American journalist. So, he goes and says, Professor Dirac, can I interview you and all this. So, and Dirac is sitting there, yes, no, no. So, he is asking you, are you the greatest genius? He says, no. So, and it goes on. So, eventually Dirac gets bored, so he just kind of gets up and starts leaving. And then this man says, wait, wait, but tell me, whom do you consider clever, who are you scared of, or something like this? Who do you think is your superior? And Dirac stops and says, Weyl, and leaves the room. So, that Hermann Weyl suggested that what we should do is to define AI equal to, and I hope I pull this off correctly. I feel like Harry Potter movie, you know, to try to do some magic and should work. There is an I introduced. So, and BI are, of course, with the opposite sign, minus IKI. So, there are two independent linear combinations introduced. And now, let us see what we get with their commutation. So, if I take AI AJ, so here what we did was there is I times K I J J but I have here a JK commutator. So to reverse order of J and K, I get a minus sign on the commutator, which I put here. But now the order of JI has got reversed. So if I change order of JI in the epsilon, I get a minus sign. So there is, so firstly it became plus I, but then a minus because the epsilon sign changed. So I get a minus I. This is straightforward. So I get both plus signs, which looks very good, except that JI, JJ, KI, KJ should also have given I times. So these two should have added. Okay. So I claim that this is equal to 1/2 times I times epsilon IJK times JK plus. So if I pull out an I, then I will get a, okay, everything here is wrong. I get a minus I. I'm going to change the sign here and put this sign here. So these signs have to be reversed. Okay, how we did the whole matrix multiplication, but I don't know how I got it wrong. But if this is minus, this is plus, then this will become plus, this will become plus, and I will have a minus sign. And the KK commutator has a minus sign, so that will cancel this. And so I get totally 1/2 times I times epsilon IJK times JK plus I, because this becomes now a minus epsilon IJK KK, so it becomes this. So equal to I times epsilon IJK AK. So we need to fix these signs. KIKJ equal to minus I epsilon IJK JK. Let me just try to think. If I were not to do this, anyway, right now there are binary choices, as I told you, and if you flip some signs, then some signs will change. I do know that this is all this also in some convention, this is the algebra. And so let me just write down the book name. This is field theory, a primer. Modern primer. So if you use these conventions and then introduce these A's, then the AI satisfy exactly as if it is SU2 algebra. More importantly, A and B mutually commute. So this we can check by just running through this algebra, because if you want to calculate AB commutator, all you have to do is replace this by a minus sign. But you can see that changing that sign does all the mischief, because this first term will remain the same. This term will change sign because of this and this. But KJ will not change sign, and KK will change sign. So the relative signs of the things that were supposed to add actually become opposite, and A and B then commute. And finally, we can work out BI BJ. This turns out to be, not surprisingly, I epsilon IJK BK, because once you here change both of these signs, then everything will remain as it is except for the overall sign here, and you will get a JK minus IKK. So the summary is that A and B SU2 algebras, which are mutually commuting, independent of each other. Right, the A's satisfy Aij equal to I epsilon ijk ak, B satisfy the same, and the AB mutually commute. So, we say in group theory SO31 is, this is the special sign equivalence, SU2A cross SU2B. It boils down to some SU2s. These are not genuine SU2s, they are pseudo SU2s because of the introduction of the I in this convention. But then, nor is this a full orthogonal group, it is some SO31. But this trick allows us to reduce at least the representations of Lorentz group to two SU2 groups. It is just like two different spins. So, the A can take any value minus L to plus L, and B can LA to plus minus LA to plus LA. L has independent quantum number going from minus LB to plus LB. So, we will see more about it next time.